And for more on the summit, we go to Ellen Tauscher, the Undersecretary of State for Arms Control and International Security. She joins us from the Washington Convention Center, where the summit is being held. Madam Secretary, welcome.
Thank you, Jim. How are you?
Just fine. First, on the issue of Iran, what exactly has the United States and China agreed to when it comes to the next moves on Iran and its nuclear program?
Well, Jim, I'm not going to go into the details of that because this is a very comprehensive discussion among many countries, as you know. Secretary Clinton met with the P5 plus one, which is Germany, last night. But suffice it to say that the United States reached out its hand, President Obama, as a new president, reached out his hand to the Iranians for what we called the persuasion track, to engage, to talk about how we can move forward to prevent and persuade Iran not to build nuclear weapons. That has not worked. It has not satisfied our concerns, nor satisfied the concerns of the region or many countries. The pressure track includes sanctions, and that is an ongoing negotiation that the president is conducting with Secretary Clinton.
But it would be a mistake to suggest that China has agreed to go along with tougher sanctions, correct?
Well, I think that what's safe to say, Jim, is that it was a very big move for President Hu to be here. And I understand that he and President Obama had a very lengthy meeting. We'll have to see how that has turned out. But it's very clear that many countries are as concerned as we are about Iran's recalcitrance to work on the persuasion track and believe that they need to be convinced not to build nuclear weapons.
All right, back to the more formal proceedings here. Today's statement, and President Obama underlined it today in his speech and then, of course, again tonight in the news conference. But what does he mean when he says these countries, 48, 49 countries, have agreed to secure, to essentially lock down their nuclear supplies in 4 years? What does that mean?
Well, the president has a very comprehensive strategy, Jim, that he outlined originally a year ago in Prague. And today we have agreement from countries like Chile and Canada and Mexico and the Ukraine to take the highly enriched uranium that is either in their reactors or is in storage and move it either to the United States and Russia for disposition. And as the president said, that we have an agreement today that Secretary Clinton signed with the Russians to eliminate 34,000 metric tons of plutonium, which could have made 17,000 weapons. So this is an effort the president has made very clear to the 47 heads of state that whether you're a nuclear power with nuclear weapons or you have civilian peaceful nuclear power in your country, it's everyone's responsibility to make sure that nuclear material, know-how, technology does not get in the hands of terrorists and that new states don't acquire it.
So this means to prevent the possibility of somebody stealing it, selling
yes.
it,
yes.
or giving it away? I mean, is it,
yes.
is it in all of the above and more?
It's all of the above and more. And as you saw when the president last week released our nuclear posture review, he's working very hard to reduce the roles of nuclear weapons for the United States, but at the same time make investments to make sure that we have the safest stockpile. But in the end, he is very clear that nuclear terrorism is a significant issue and a threat. That is why he brought the 47 heads of state here to have very cozy conversations with them and to spend a day and a half on this issue. These are all very busy people, as is the president. But he believes that this is a singular threat that needs everybody to work together. And these commitments that these countries have made are sizable and really begins to reduce the kinds of stockpiles around the world that could eventually, if not protected, fall into the hands of terrorists and other bad elements.
Well, what are the top threats, the loose nukes, so to speak? Where do they come from? Are they from the old Soviet Union countries, or are they from Pakistan? Give me a list.
Well, I think, Jim, you know, we're not going to name names,
sure.
but
okay.
it's clear that after the fall of the Soviet Union, Kazakhstan and the other countries worked together to bring their material under control. But there are lots of countries that have peaceful uses and reactors that need to be protected better. There are countries with radioactive isotopes and other things that need to be protected better. It's not just nuclear weapons or former nuclear weapons, but it's the reactors and any kind of nuclear material and the know-how and the technology that, when put together, could give terrorists or other bad actors the opportunity to harm innocent people.
And that's the reason the president said today that the threat of nuclear attack is higher now than it was 20 years ago when the Cold War ended?
That's right. The president has said this consistently, and I think it's proven by the intelligence estimates. We have more states now looking to acquire nuclear weapons than we did even 15 years ago. And we have a lot more nuclear reactors out there. And while they don't have highly enriched uranium that could be used for bomb-making material, they have radioactive material that could be used for dirty bombs. So it's important that we understand the context of this. But it's a very big agenda. It was wonderful to see the 47 heads of state here. It was wonderful to see the president present so clearly what he believes is an important opportunity to work together. And these agreements, I think, are sizable and significant and will prove to be creating more security and safety.
Is it correct to say, then, that things will happen as a result of what happened here these last 2 days? It would not have happened had there not been this meeting?
That's absolutely positively true. The president has not only communique, but a work agreement, and every country has signed on to it. Every country has a list of to-dos, so to speak. The people that organize this are called Sherpas. They are either the foreign minister or the ambassador, and they are going to stay in touch. And the new conference for 2012 has been announced in South Korea. So this is not a one-time event where we had one-time deliverables. This is an ongoing thing with significant agreements between heads of state to deliver between now and 2012, when South Korea will host the next nuclear security summit.
What are the procedures for finding out whether or not these 47 countries actually did what they said they would do at this in this communique today?
Well, part of it was that we have very strong bilateral relationships and multilateral relationships, and one of them is with the IAEA. The Director General of the IAEA, Yukio Amano, was here and was a very big participant in this. So we have both the multilateral relationships and we have these commitments that are very direct as deliverables, plus we had the IAEA in the middle of it, and they certainly will be involved in monitoring what these promises are.
Is it correct to say, Madam Secretary, that there was very little hard negotiating that went on here, that most of these, if not all, of these various leaders came to Washington, along with President Obama, in agreement, and all they came to do was shake hands and work out the paperwork and issue a communique?
No, I think that is missing the point. I think the truth is, Jim, that while we had a plenary session with all of these heads of state working together over a day and a half, there were many pull asides. There were lots of conversations going on between the foreign ministers and the people accompanying the heads of state and the heads of state themselves on a myriad of issues. This was a unique opportunity in one building to have in Washington, D.C., 47 heads of state that have many different issues to deal with that are regional, their neighbors they wanted to talk to, or even people across the world that they needed to talk to about many different issues. So I would say that there was a lot of activity for the security summit itself, and certainly President Obama was in the chair the entire time. But I think that this side action also was tremendously helpful to advance many of the causes that we in the United States believe in.
On the human level, what was the atmosphere? What was the tone like among all these folks?
Well, I was in many of the meetings with Secretary Clinton, and I was able to see the interactions. And I think that what's clear is that there was overall appreciation for calling this meeting. I think many of the heads of state believe that this was an issue that was important, but that until the United States and President Obama put it out there as something that they could discuss and get ramped up on, that it was one of those things that was off to the side. But I think that, as usual, when somebody like President Obama brings an issue forward, there was a lot of excitement and a lot of appreciation and a lot of commitment. And I think that the meetings that he had himself with heads of state on the side and the meetings of Secretary Clinton will prove to bring benefits to the American people for a very long time.
All right. Secretary Tauscher, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.